here's my take. The attacks in Brussels on the heels of those in Paris and San Bernardino have stoked an already white-hot debate about Islamic terrorism in the United States. Many in the West, including the two Republican presidential frontrunners, Donald Trump and Ted Cruz, urge a campaign that targets Muslim communities more directly, searching for those who might be prone to religious extremism and thus terrorism. But the recent bombings in Europe are being perpetrated by a new generation of terrorists who are upending our previous understanding of what motivates such people and how to find and stop them. To put it simply, today's terrorists are not religious extremists who became radicals, but rather radicals who then became religious extremists. The difference is crucial. Look at the two brothers who planned and executed the Brussels bombings, Ibrahim and Khalid al-Bakrawi. Born into a working-class immigrant family from Morocco, they were not particularly religious and early on chose a life of crime. As the New York Times reported, by their mid-20s, the two had participated in carjackings and armed robberies. Ibrahim was sentenced to 9 years in prison for attempted murder, his brother 5 years for armed robbery. And then, it seems, in prison or after, their path to jihad began. Their story is strikingly similar to those of many of the other terrorists in Belgium and France. Few were devout Muslims. Abdelhamid Abaoud, the ringleader of the Paris attacks, is said to have regularly used drugs and drank alcohol, as did many of his comrades in arms. In August 2014, the New Statesman reported on two British jihadis, both 22, who before leaving Birmingham for Syria, bought copies of Islam for Dummies and the Quran for Dummies. Writing about young French jihadis, Olivier Roy, a French scholar of Islam, points out that almost none have a background in political activism, say Palestine, fundamentalist Islam, or social conservatism. Their radicalization arises around the fantasy of heroism, violence, and death, not of Sharia and utopia, he writes. The Islamic State is the ultimate gang, celebrating violence for its own sake. These young men, and some women, are usually second-generation Europeans. In fact, Roy points out that often they are revolting against their more traditional, devout immigrant parents. They're unsure of their identity, rooted in neither the old country nor the new. They face discrimination and exclusion, and in this context, they choose a life of rebellion, crime, and then the ultimate forbidden adventure, jihad. Why are these findings so important? Well, they paint a picture of a new kind of terrorist, one who is less drawn into terrorism through religion, but rather who has chosen the path of terror as the ultimate act of rebellion against the modern world, and who then finds an ideology that can justify his desires. Radical Islam does provide that off-the-shelf ideology, easily available through the internet and social media, but it is the end point in the chain, not the start. This still means that Muslims have to battle and eradicate the cancer in their midst that is radical Islam. But it does suggest that for Western law enforcement, bugging mosques, patrolling Muslim community centers, and even fighting fundamentalist Muslims might be focusing attention in the wrong direction if the goal is to find terrorists. Those people might instead be in bars, drug alleys, unemployment lines, in prisons, getting radicalized before they get Islamized. For more, go to cnn.com/Farid and read my Washington Post column this week. And let's get